has not grown dim, has not grown soft. With the onset of a body that's slowing down, winding down, my spirit has not diminished in wanting to be a part of the church, build the church, and reach anybody and everybody I can.
That's right. Amen.
If you have your Bibles, we're going to go, and we've kind of, if you've been here on Wednesday nights, I've been teaching a lot from Paul's writings, and we're going to use it as a launching point. I didn't title this today, even though when I sent it to the media team this morning, it's just got my words that I applied to it with my thought. 2 Timothy 2:20 and 21. I'm going to launch here. It's going to be in the house of the Lord.
Yes, amen.
Give someone a high five, a hug, or a holy handshake that's nearby. Don't walk across the room. Just someone nearby. Hallelujah. Some of you take an hour to get back to your seat. You don't want to do that. I want to be done in less than an hour. How about that? I'll tell you, we can get there if you'll get with me today.
Come on, amen. Amen, Pastor.
I want to kind of create an imagery when you read the Bible. And I think, really, that's what's kept me. I got a book of pain just like everybody else. I think the difference is I'm allowing God to help me walk through the pain, the struggle, and the trouble, and not change the fact that I'm going to live for God. That's, I got to be in mind.
Yeah, yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen.
I want to die here. I mean, not literally, not right now. Just get what I'm saying. I want God to be forgotten.
Yes. Amen.
I want to find some rocking chair somewhere, find some sort of spiritual retirement. Where I'm sitting back. No.
Come on, right here.
Amen. I want
Amen.
My soul. I want you to catch the imagery of a man trying to speak to someone young, like you wonderful ladies, and trying to inspire them, knowing, because you go, you'll find where Paul has listed some of his pain, Pam, I call it. He's been through some stuff, but he talks about vessels here. And he's really talking about people.
Yes.
But in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth. I like the fact how he says it. There's a shift here, because I'm not a prize. I'm not a showpiece.
Amen. Amen.
I'm thankful for the wood and the earth and vessels that are listed here. I'm just a clay pot.
Yes, amen.
I'm just a clay pot. I'm not something you put up in a curio. I'm not something you're going to go look for at an antique shop to try to get a deal to make you make. No, I'm not a Ming vase or anything like that. I'm just a wash pot.
Come on, preacher. Come on.
The differentiation that comes here, some to honor and some to dishonor. Reading it properly, there's even gold vessels that are dishonorable.
Yeah.
And we know the Bible talks about not looking on the outside of someone or judging people as they're worth by monetary value. God sees value where we don't.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
So while he's talking, he's given this, because this is pretty crucial to this young man, Timothy. He's getting serious. But he's also giving hope.
That's right. Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen.
Don't buy into the world's economy.
Come on.
Don't buy into their value system. So some people, their biggest claim to fame is worldly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was on the cover of Time. I made a lot of money. I'm famous. People know who I am. Big.
Come on. Come on, Pastor.
Who cares? Who cares if you get all that and you don't make heaven?
Well,
big deal is if God looks at you as a vessel of dishonor. You have to understand, every vessel is made.
Yes.
I'm to go to Jeremiah 18, so we're normally going to talk about the potter's wheel, the potter's house.
Yes, amen.
We're all vessels.
That's right.
We're all being poured out
to
something.
That's right.
Some are living godly, some are living worldly, and some are trying to find that non-existent place within, because
that's
the Lord's already said you can't serve both.
That's right.
God said we've got to pick a side.
That's right.
He's saying, Timothy, you've got to pick a side, but he's using some terms here that open it up a little bit more for us, for our minds to get a grip on this. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor. And he goes into some stuff, which I'm not going to today. Sanctified and meet for the master's use. And prepared unto every good work.
Amen.
If you've been around here, you've heard me say this, and I'm just going to be honest with you today. I do not have an elegant oratory right now. Paul, I'm not going to walk. Sorry, I'm just not going to have it today. Can God use you? Can he use you and you not feel used? Can he use you despite the pain, the cracks, and the struggles, and the wounds? And are you still willing to say, I don't want to be on the sidelines. I know that hurt. And I got knocked up against another pot, and I got a chip here, and I got a mark and a scratch here. And use me.
Jesus.
See, I'm guilty of this. Let me get back to this. Let's pray. Let's talk to the Lord. Jesus, we love you. I need you, God. I'm speaking to some vessels of every which one you have made. You have given us the privilege and the honor of being involved in the choice as to our direction. I pray that somehow, some way, in the frailty of my words, that I am able, with your help, to help someone make the decision and the choice to stay in your hands regardless of anything else. Anoint us, bless us, be with us.
Yes.
Help me to do good, Lord.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus.
And everybody said amen.
Amen.
You can be seated.
Amen.
If we were to step out into the parking lot, let me finish that thought. You go out there and you look at my truck and it's almost 20 years old. It's clean. But if you'd have looked at it a few years ago, I was really tired after church one morning. I made a right-hand turn right out of the church next to this wall that's here. And I altered the wall and I altered the truck. I wrecked it, scratched it, broke the wall down. Just crystallized, just, you know. Luckily, there was only a few people here to laugh at me. They laughed. They made fun of me. You know, I deserved it. You know, but sometimes you have to realize we do stupid stuff.
Yeah,
we do. Can we be real?
Yeah.
I've done stupid stuff. I got scars and marks and thoughts and issues and heartache over dumb stuff that I did. Where am I going with this? In other words, you go out there now, you can't see the evidence of that wreck because I had it refinished.
That's good.
Restored.
That's good. That's good.
I got it out of my hands and I put it in a master craftsman's hands.
Oh, Jesus.
You can't tell now that it happened.
Oh, Jesus.
Come on. In my pride, it bothered me driving down the road with that, Mark. See, because even pastors struggle with image. Because I know you all don't.
Well.
I know you don't have a mirror in your house. You don't care. You got that little compact in your purse. You don't. Right?
Come on. Keep it real. Come on, Pastor. It's true.
We struggle with image, and sadly, we want to look like a certain whatever it is that floats your boat. We want to have that image. And so we do whatever we can. And I'm gonna honor church, and I'm always gonna wear my best. And I, excuse me for taking my tie off this morning. I'll be honest that I can barely, because of the problems I have with the centering thumb joints, barely get that collar popped over. I finally got it popped over, and then I'm in church over here, and I realized that now the collar stays all flipped around. So I said, you know what? Jesus never wore a tie, so I took it off. So I'm not trying to be dishonorable. I'm just not going to wear it right now.
Amen.
Why don't we be so caught up in images that we miss the reality of who we really are?
That's good.
You know, God knows who you really are.
Hello. Yeah. Hello. Hello.
Okay. Now I'm going to go to Jeremiah and get to my text, and I really don't want to keep this long, so if you get me with it real quick, we'll get out of here real quick, and you can go try to do this living for God stuff where it really matters.
Amen. Amen.
Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 through 6. Now, I'll get into here, I wrote a little bit here, and I'll read through that, then I'll preach a little bit, hopefully, in Jesus' name. And the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house. Listen here. He's telling pastor, listen, yes. Jeremy, come on, Jeremy.
Yep.
I got to give you an analogy because I want you to teach something to my people.
Hello, amen.
I'm going to be honest with you. It really hasn't changed. He still does stuff like this.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
And there I will cause thee to hear my words. Not going to hear words. He's going to see, but God's going to speak to him and say, I got something for my people.
Hello.
Then I went down. Notice he obeyed. One of the first things about being a pastor, being a minister, you ain't got time to get offended. You ain't got time. You just got to do what God's asking you to do.
That's good. That's good. Come on, pastor.
Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels, and the vessel that he made of the clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made again another vessel. What a beautiful picture that we're given here. It's not hidden. We got it, right?
Yes, amen.
All right. Made again another vessel, but listen, it's as seemed good to the potter to make it. You know what that tells me? The clay yielded to the hands.
Yes, come on, pastor.
And if you've been around God a little bit longer than 5 minutes, you realize, well, that's easier said than done.
Hello? Hello?
God stars proving.
Hello?
I know I should have done it this way, but I wanted to do it that way. I got out of his hands, and I got the stars, the emotional. But we don't want to go there today.
Come on, preach it.
We all should.
Preach it.
Then the word of the Lord came to me. There's a preacher listening to what God's trying to say. Oh, house. I love the O there. Oh, God loves you. God loves his people. He vehemently cares. Oh, house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter? God is trying to tell the preacher to him, I can do the same thing with your mess. I can do the same thing with your hurt. Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in mine. Notice, you've got to stay in his hands. You've got to stay in his will. You can't allow hurt. You can't allow pain. You can't allow excuses to get you out of his hand. Oh, house of Israel. You know, Jeremiah is one of the longest books in the Bible. The weeping prophet's got a lot to cry about, I guess. The book reveals for us critical periods in the life and times of Israel. It's filled with laments, divine oracles, judgments, prophetic speeches, and a lot of symbolic action, which is what we're looking at right now with the potter. Our text is representative of a symbol in action. Some people use the term, it's parabolic, it's anthropomorphic, it's just something natural to help us study something supernatural with God working in our lives. Are you hearing? Are you with me?
Amen.
Yet if you realize, and look at 18, it holds the sovereignty of God,
yes.
Almighty God. But you know what it also does? It elevates human responsiveness. I have to respond to his hand. not just God knows and God's will. No, it's I'm going to yield to his hands.
Amen.
It's not just God can. It's I yield.
Yes. Amen.
We have to respond to the hand. In fact, it was in the lyrics of the song they sang. And they didn't know what I was preaching when they get together. I didn't get this done until this morning. I was really hearing from God trying to get this right. But the hand, the touch, the word of God is God working us as an individual to become a vessel of honor.
Yes.
Of use.
Yes.
That he wants to make us.
Yes. Amen.
Listen, trying to be like somebody else is a waste of who you are.
Amen, Pastor.
Stop. I'm going to be honest with that. Look, I don't want to be like another preacher. I'm going to be me.
Come on, that's right.
Now, I'll be honest with you. If I hear a preacher say a good thing, I'm going to say it too.
Well, hello.
I'm not dumb. I don't have to reinvent the wheel. I got wheels on my car. I don't need to make another kind.
Come on, Pastor.
But I'm still going to be me.
Yeah.
And you know what? You need to be who you're supposed to be. I can't do you, and you can't do me, so be the best you, and I'll be the best me. And God, make us who you want us to be.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
So we're given a graphic view of this as the potter's hand is applied to the raw clay. A brief few words encompassing the process of our human lives in the mighty hand of a great creator. That God openly shows how the clay has a say in its ultimate outcome.
Come on.
You have a say.
Come on.
Usability or unusableness.
Jesus.
Will it yield itself? Will we yield ourselves? God is no respecter of persons, but he honors and respects how people live and what they do.
Right.
Are you getting what I'm saying? See, we live in a world that, oh, it doesn't matter what you do. You haven't read your Bible. If there's vessels, some honor, some to dishonor, what's the difference? What they're used for. If you're used for the world, okay, it's going to be hard to step in and be used of God.
Hello? Hello?
So we see in the theme of our text in Jeremiah, divine justice opens to or are tempered by our response.
Yes.
To God.
Yes.
Everybody here is listening to this, but everybody will have a varied response to this. The judgment, the outcome, the overall finality is correlated with human action or inaction. Make sense?
Yeah.
One writer said that in Jeremiah there is a dynamic of deed and consequence. So we see that God is open to, here you go, stay with me, and willing to change his mind.
Come on. Come on, Pastor.
There's some of y'all here. Oh, wait a minute. Bear with me. I got Bible. Whether in Exodus, Jeremiah, Amos, Jonah, when God changes God's mind, a lot of times it's because it's in favor of humans. God changes God's mind for the intent from destruction to the intent to save. He does that.
Yes, he does. Amen.
The clay was marred. He didn't stop. He didn't toss it. I'm God.
I'm going to use it.
I'm going to make it again.
Come on, that's it.
That's
it.
Genesis chapter 18 gives us another picture. The Lord is so friendly with one vessel, he decides to confer with them. And he said, shall I hide from Abraham the thing which I do? Say that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of earth shall be blessed in him. Abraham, a willing vessel, directly connected with the potter. The potter saying, wow, God wants you involved in what he's doing.
That's right.
God wants that connection if you'll stay in his hand. Good. He's talking to someone who's, God said, come out of that, your history. Come out of your past, and because he would stay. relationship.
Come on. Amen.
A lot of people want that kind of relationship without that kind of yielding.
That's good.
I sing as good as them, but are you yield to him like them?
Hello?
I preach as good as them, but are you as yield to them?
Come on.
To God as them.
Yeah.
You see, it's an unseen and tangible difference that sometimes isn't recognizable because we all kind of, well, we all look like the same kind of vessel. And so there's this dialogue that happens between the potter and the vessel saying, he starts off, if there are 50 righteous.
Yeah.
If there are, all the way down, if there are 10 raw, pliable lumps of clay, God, will you spare it?
Come on, Pastor.
I mean, some of us have forgotten where we come from. And we want God to bring judgment, and God is looking for vessels today that will say, you know what, God? Let's spare them. Let's look for some pliable. Let's look for some rawness. Let's try to find some yielding. Don't stop working with them, God. God changed his mind because he found a vessel that started to become concerned with other vessels. See, the sad place is we get somewhere in God. We live for God. We learn how to put on a suit and tie. All of a sudden, we think we stand around in a curio cabinet looking around at all the other.
Help me, Lord. Come on.
But you don't want to get your hands dirty anymore. You want to be a curio cabinet vessel instead of a wash pot.
Jesus.
You're above certain things. And I'll say, hey, if you're above serving, you're beyond leading.
That's good. Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Time does not permit me really to give a thorough exegesis of the text. But I would encourage you to read verses 7 through 12. It's deep, highly critical, and important. But verse 4 is where I want to focus. It says, and the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. In the hands of God, you can be messed up. So he made it again, another vessel that seemed good for the potter to make it. It is really just a few moments today to, like Jeremiah, leave you with a message of hope.
Yes, amen.
But it is really up to us and our choice.
Right.
I can preach and get you excited about hope and excited about what God can do, but really that's not what I'm trying to get you. I'm trying to get you. I'm trying to convince you that you're better yielded to God for an outcome.
Oh, come on, Pastor. Come on, amen.
Because it's up to us, workable clay, stubborn clay, hope or human, the vessel the potter was making of clay was marred, it was spoiled, it was messed up, but it was in the potter's hands. Oh, that I could just get this across today, that you know what, it doesn't matter what's going on in your life if you're in the potter's hands. See, people will disqualify you, but God will say, I'm not finished yet.
That's right. Come on.
You know, I've got a vehicle in the other part of town there, and right now, I don't know that anybody that doesn't know much about car, I'm not giving you nothing for that empty shell. I mean, it is gutted down to the bare metal. All it's got in it is third member, rear differential, and body gets pretty much, it's a shell. But in the right hands, when it's finished,
it's more than that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. It's
how can we look at a vehicle that's just metal, rubber, left, and go, wow, and not realize there's a lot of potential wows in here today?
Amen.
Yes.
There's a lot of wows here that some people, they got this to work on that. Hold on. You don't understand. It's not a big deal. They're in the master's hands. It can happen. It can come up just like that vehicle that come rolling out of the garage one day. Finished and polished and amazing. It's not how it starts. It's how it finishes.
Amen.
I'm telling you, it's not how you start. It's how you finish.
Amen.
Put yourself in the master's hands.
Amen.
And you can remake. Christian, you throw me in the kitchen with some flour, some eggs, and whatever else, I ain't coming out of there with a cake. Would you take some of these ladies around here and you put them in there, and all of a sudden it's dinner time and you're going to eat like a king pot because you put something that don't look like anything in a master's hand and you get an awesome result. And what God is telling, God is saying this: you in my hands, I can get it done. You in my hands, I can finish it. You call yourself a mess, but I'm not going to make my miracle. Analogy, but it's what my little brain came up with. I remember, how many of you save the little 2 liter pop bottles? You don't save those? That's okay, we don't either. But I remember seeing a picture of a guy in a third world country that flattened and took some string and made some flip-flops out of it.
Hello?
Hello? Well, if you ain't got no shoes, look, if I'm working on a project in the house and I need a bucket, you better hope something fucking valuable ain't laid. I don't care if it's stainless steel or man, if I might need one more, it's going to be used for that.
Yeah.
I don't know how many times. Come on, ladies, how many times have you turned a shoe into a hammer? I'm going to hang this picture right here. You'll grab a shoe and what I'm trying to say is, maybe you've messed up here, but God can remake and reuse over here.
Yes. Amen.
Another vessel. God has the power and the ability, and I want to add this, the desire to remake you.
Yes.
You know, I remember. Anybody remember walking in out of Home Depot? I think it was in the 90s. They were doing that extreme makeover thing, and they had this guy that was going around, and they'd find people, they'd send them off on vacation, and they'd go home and remake their home. Now they're doing it with people. Come on. Some of y'all, you know, you thought about, man, I need a little touch, a little lift here, a little augmentation over here. I'm looking old up. That's a lying dog. You know you thought about that. I need to get on a diet plan. We all want that makeover on the external side because we want that image.
Oh, Jesus.
And they wheel that, they bring that family and they reveal the house and they're like, oh! They're blown away because now he's got his dad and she's got, I don't know what we all like, women, whatever it is. The right pants. And you're blown away. You're so excited about the redone house or the redone face. Or guys, the redone car. And we're excited about being able to take something and restore it, reuse it, rebuild the house. And it's wonderful. And we're excited about that. But when it comes to us, leave me alone, God. Get off me, God. Oh, I'm fine, just like I am. Hello. Don't touch me. Get your hands off me. We find people who want to go to a church or go to a place where they're always made to feel good. And so they never get that remake moment. I didn't know God could do this. because there's a call that's gone out. And God is calling his people to a place, but the world wants you just to do an exterior makeover. Don't really get fixed. Just go get a facelift and pop some pills where you feel like you're something you're not. Are you here? God is telling us he can and he will. And he desires to remake us. Nobody will tell a child here today, you don't have hope. Well, why would I tell an adult, you don't have hope? God can still remake you where you are. If he can make a 75-year-old man a father.
Yes, yes. Yeah, amen.
Are you hearing me? Wait a minute, 100-year-old man, 75-year-old woman. Let me get that right. Hello? Not that I mean y'all be running out there trying to do that. Leave that in the hands of God. The verse, the whole concept, gives us important information to know. First, the vessel, can you get me? Was a work in progress. Tell your neighbor right now, I'm not finished. Stop acting like you're finished. I'm taking you off the hook. Quit walking around like you got it all together and you have to always have the right answer or the right thing to say. You don't.
Come on, Pastor.
You don't.
Come on.
I'm a work in progress. Amen. I'm not complete. God is not finished with me yet. So if you're conversing and work with me and you find a hard spot, don't worry. God saw long
That's
before
right.
you
He's going to see it through. Come on. Come on.
Don't throw the towel in on anybody.
Amen.
Leave that for God to do.
Amen.
Don't you start living that way. Don't you start living that way. Believe in them just like you believe for yourself. He's not finished with me. Secondly, the vessel was in the potter's hand. Although spoiled, although marred, it was in his hand. Third, it was remade into a vessel that the potter was pleased with. I think that's where we lose out. I like to do something I'm pleased with that. Right? You go out and do some yard work, you clean, come on, you go away, you clean the bathroom, you step back, you change the little doilies or whatever, the little seashells, your little soaps. Yeah, you're all pleased with yourself. You go, you wait for cousin to come and walk in there, you want him to go, oh, and you don't give a rip, man. Let me just take my shower. Where's my body wash? Oh, that's nice, honey. What's for dinner? We like to be pleased with ourselves.
Yes.
You know where we get that from? God likes you to be pleased with what he's doing. How many of us are yielding to allow God to step in? Now that's what I wanted to do with you.
Yes.
That's where I wanted to get you. You have fought me tooth and nail, but I've never given up. I'm going to get you here. If you yield, I'm going to get you there.
Yes.
If you yield, I've got plans for you. You can't even. If you
will
just humble yourself, it'll blow you away. But if you will trust me and my hands, I'll get you to a place. If you just get out of the way for 5 minutes and let me get my hand back in your life, you're going to find out I'll do something in 5 minutes that you wasted 5 years fighting with me about. As far as I can see from the text, it's okay to be marred and messed up if you're still in the potter's hands.
That's right. Yeah.
But if you're not in the potter's hands and you're messed up, everybody's like, So in reading the text, by the time you reach verse 6, it might appear to be a message of doom. But verse 4 lets us know it's a message of hope. It's hope for tomorrow. It's hope for the future. It's hope for our children. It's hope for our church. It's hope for our nation.
Yes.
It's hope for our families.
Yes.
See, he is the potter and we are the clay. In other words, it ain't over. God's got his hands on us. As the potter's wheel turns, it lets us know there's hope. The potter, the master craftsman, does not set out to make a flawed vessel. Here, let me make a messed up one. But sometimes our material sometimes has some issues. And part of plans, things of usefulness and beauty that sometimes were marred and even messed up, but thanks be to God that we're still in the master's hands.
Yeah, amen.
When the potter noticed with his expert eye and experienced tactile perception that the vessel was marred or still make it
yes.
a vessel.
Yes.
Though it's messed up, the vessel still had merit for the master.
Yes.
Right.
Oh, though it's messed up, it's in my hands.
Right.
There's value here. There's a miracle here. That I can make something out of it if it's in my hand. I believe God has a purpose
yes.
and God has a plan. And if it's still in the master's hand, I got hope. You know why I'm here today? I want to make
God.
Sure
oh,
I'm in the map. There's hope.
Yes.
Our struggles, our problems, our proclivities, as
yes.
I like to say.
Yeah.
The Bible talks about the rich young ruler who thought he was truly motivated by the mandates of Christ. He had achieved some status, and he'd been godly. There's no question. He'd been doing it right. He had kept all the commandments, but when he went to Jesus expecting to get the blue ribbon and the trophy and to be set up in the curio cabinet next to the fine china display of perfectionist, God said, I'll tell you what, Jesus said, I'll tell you what, you come and put yourself in my hands, I can tell you where the mark is. I can tell you, go and give. Go give. Why not? He'd already obeyed all the commandments, right? He was close to God. But you can't say you're close to God because of all the convictions and the things you won't do. And he turns around and says, this is something I need you to do. Go give. He was not really motivated by the mandates of the master. He really wasn't. And so he walked away from the water. How many of us have been like that?
Amen. Come on.
Don't ask me to forgive. Don't ask me to love.
Come on,
she makes me mad. They make me mad.
Come on, Pastor.
We are quick to name. Be proud of the things and convictions that we don't do. And the things that we have in place for God. But when asked to give, when asked to step closer to Christ, when asked to walk with Christ, carry it. Oh, wait a minute.
Yep.
Well, that stings a little bit.
That's heavy. Come on, Pastor.
If you see someone in need, go give. You see somebody hurting, go give. It's easy to take in and receive God. God already commands on it. Okay, now that you got that far, the real test is to give. Give your life, give your time, give your effort. We like to give to ourselves and we like to give our family, but God really checks us with our neighbor. That's why you have neighbors. And that's why he's more concerned about your condition with your neighbors than your condition with yourself, because we all want to.
Amen.
We'll do ourselves up. We'll put the right house, the right clothes, the right everything. Oh man, that poor neighbor, they're looking bad. Go get it. See, if we're in the hands of the master, we moved on them to make the meaningful difference the way he did. With what God needs. He needed a certain kind of vessel. If your son asked for bread, would you give him a stone? If God asks for a servant, what are you going to give him? I'm sorry, I didn't say you guys. That'd be real weird.
Come on now.
First Samuel, the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance for the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth, for a man looketh only outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. God said, for a certain kind of message from you, from me.
Yeah.
And like the master, we must be compassionate. We cannot see a need and ignore it, because when God had a need, he had to send the right
people. Come on.
Saul wasn't cutting it. Saul was too concerned about it being a, being someone looked upon. He liked the title king, but not the job. He liked the accolades, but not the responsibilities.
Uh-huh.
Ooh. You see, like the master, we've got to be compassionate. We cannot see a need and ignore it. If we're in the master's hands, we'll be compelled by compassion to give, to risk. David stepped up from nowhere, from nothing. They overlooked him. He didn't win in fifth of the army. But he was the one who gave and risked his life for everybody.
Right.
It's easy to want to look and be head and shoulders like a Saul, but God's looking for David. I know. It's not profound, it's not prophetic. It may not even be pleasing. But let me admonish you not to give up.
Yes, yes.
It's easy to be the Saul and get yourself in your tent and have all your polished armor and all your trophies on the wall and be the king and you got the titles and you got this, but everybody's out by the side just kind of looking at you like, wow, you look good.
Hello.
finished if we do. We're not finished if we do this. Don't throw in the towel. Go ahead and give, but never give up. Go ahead and give. Don't lose out with God over whatever it is that you think is more valuable than your place with Him. God, I want to stay on the wheels. I don't care about anything.
Come on, Pastor.
I want to stay in the Master's hands. I don't care about it. Maybe I'm not making good sense. Some of us are mindful. Some of us are still motivated. And some of us are moved to action.
Come on, Pastor. Amen.
I may not have all three right now, but I'm malleable enough. I got a couple or I got one. I'm staying in the Master's hands till I get all of them. He's not done working on me. I got the mindful. I can see the need. Lord, help me to start being an answer to the need.
Yes.
Help me to respond to the. Help me to quit just looking at it and just being there, be an answer. Are you hearing what I'm saying? God didn't give you the resources to be a rebel. He gave you the resources to be the answer.
Amen.
Restored, and that means we can be made new.
Come on, amen.
Yeah, you and your old carcass can be made new. Now, there's a ray of hope here, and I know some of you are just kind of, man, this rough pastor, that shines through in verse 4. The Master does not fashion a vessel to our liking.
Come on, amen.
Look, if I'd have fashioned me, I could sing like, what was the name of that guy we were listening to yesterday? The singers he was copying. Not the Celine Dion. I won't sing like a chick. I won't sing like the dude. Some guy, Anthony Bocelli, or some guy just, raw. I mean, it was just beautiful. It was just wonderful. I fashioned myself to sing like that and have all my hair and biceps and muscles and everything. That's how I would fashion me. Because I would want you guys to keep. But you don't believe me? That's why Hollywood stars are famous. Because you're all like, ooh. That's why you spend money to go see athletes. Well, you guys, I don't know. You spend all the money in accolades. Oh, that's my guy. That's my player. That's my team. No. Because you're esteeming people.
Come on.
You're investing in people that don't know nothing about you. I'm not saying, man, I got something planned for you.
Yes.
Here it is.
Oh, Jesus.
Come on.
Young people, I'm trying to get you today, too.
Hello?
God has a plan. God has a purpose. God has an idea. If you'll stay in His hand, I'm telling you, He will work a work on the wheels that'll blow your mind and everyone around you. If you'll release your will and say, not my will, but Thy will be done. I know. I'm sorry. You want to be a glorious vessel that's on display in God's trophy cabinet, but only brought out for special occasions. But that's not what He's looking for.
That's it.
Yeah.
Amen.
It's not what He needs. That's not what He's
making.
Amen. He's looking for a good old reliable pot for the thirsty. He's looking for a good old reliable wash pot for the dirty.
Hear it.
He's just looking for maybe even a clean cooking pot to feed the hungry.
Come on.
He's just looking for someone to reach out and be a wash basin for the wounded. Are you willing to be what God needs? A vessel that is formed. Please, the potter. We must remember that the potter has in mind is what He wants to make.
Right.
I want to be what the potter uses. Can I say this? We might discard what the potter desires.
Ouch. Come on.
Oh, not them.
Come on.
They're worthless. Useless. They're ugly. I want it. See, as we walk around and look at each other, we look at vessels, but you know what God sees?
Come on, tell
us. Clay.
Hello?
Clay.
Hello?
Don't sit here feeling finished.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
You might seal your own fate.
Come on.
I wonder if someone, maybe just one person that I can get to today, can declare, I'm here, God.
Yes.
Give you my clay.
Yes.
To make me.
Yes.
gospel play.
Come on.
Make me again another vessel. I want to be used by the Master. I want to be in the Master's hand.
Amen.
I want to be a brand new, clean canvas for the artist. I want to be a fresh lump of clay. A new vessel in your hands, God. No wonder the Apostle Paul himself, a reworked vessel.
Yes.
If you don't know his story, you're going to miss that. Was the one that said, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels. There's an old story. The water bearer in India had two large pots. Carried on his staff. One at the end of the staff across his neck. One of the pots had a crack in it from being bounced around. It was perfect. The other one was immaculate. And so every day he would go down and fill his pots and carry them back to the house. And of course, the one with the crack in it would leak and splash out half the water as it made its trip back to the Master's house. So for 2 years this went on daily, and the bear delivering one full pot and one half pot of water to the Master's house. Of course, the perfect pot, now these pots are speaking to each other because I guess maybe Walt Disney was included in this, but I don't know. The perfect pot was proud of the accomplishments. I'm always delivering a full pot of water, which made the poor cracked pot. Are you with me?
Hello.
Ashamed of its own imperfection, and was miserable that it was only able to accomplish half of what it was intended. So after 2 years, what perceived bitter failure to the cracked pot, he finally blurted out, I'm ashamed of myself and I want to apologize to you. Why? Asked the bear. What are you ashamed of? I have been able for these 2 years to deliver only half my load because this crack in my side causes water to leak out all the way back to the Master's house. Because of my flaws, you have to do all the work and you don't get full value from your efforts. The water bearer felt sorry for the old cracked pot. In his compassion, he said, as we return to the Master's house, I want you to notice the beautiful flowers along the path. Indeed, as they went up the hill, the old crackpot took notice of the sun warming the beautiful wild flowers on the side of the path. And this cheered its son. However, at the end of the trail, it still felt bad because it had leaked out half of its load again, and it apologized. Still, it failed. The bearer said to the pot, did you notice that there were only flowers on your side of the path?
Hello?
But on the other side, it's barren.
Oh, Jesus.
Do you realize that I plant seeds, flowers, on that side because you leak over there every day? And now, because you leak every day, that now I'm also not only able to bring water, but I go back and I get those flowers to bless the Master's table, that I can still use you with your flaws, with your mistakes, with yours. If you'll stay in the Master's hand, he'll still use you with your weaknesses, with your mistakes. God doesn't give up on people because of some cracks and some flaws. Oh, house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter said to us? Behold, you are in the Father's
soul.
Oh,
Jesus.
Paul said, therefore, if any man remain standing, I want to close. Be in Christ. He is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Jesus.
It's been some time, but I received a letter. From one of the major automakers. The car that I had purchased was on a recall. We had some issues with it that was causing some serious trouble. I did some research about this because, sadly, I fall into the unenviable category of those that discarded the letter. I don't have time for this. Reminded of the All-American Death Trap. Anybody remember the Ford Pinto? It has become the synopsis of a corporate mismanagement and horrible design. Became a textbook example of how not to build a car. That it would explode on impact. So I did some research and I read that there are record recalls every year.
Yeah.
It blows my mind as I was recent, but Jonathan, I'm telling you, 50 million cars is not unheard of.
Yeah.
From tires, airbags, to just some utter ridiculousness.
Yeah.
So the National Highway Transportation Safety Authority,
yeah.
I said that right. They monitor and they mandate the auto companies to repair anything that doesn't meet standards. In fact, for those of you driving Volkswagen, they did a little manipulation recently and literally have been sued because they were manipulating some of the emissions. And it's interesting and sadly, I did read it, but I won't bore you with that today. But sadly, pastor falls into the category that I'm preaching at right now.
Come on, amen.
I disregarded the letter. Well, I have a reason. I no longer own the vehicle, so I didn't concern me.
Yeah.
Poor people that don't own the vehicle. But anyway, they got to get a hold of that. People ignore it. They can't help you if you don't bring the vehicle in.
That's good.
And if you don't bring in the vehicle to the maker,
hello?
They can't
hello?
They can't fix the problem.
Hello? Yes. Here. Uh-huh. Amen.
And sadly, people have been injured, hurt, even killed because they failed to heed the recall.
Hello?
The
hello?
Remake.
Hello?
Yes. Let us get our hands back on it and we can fix it.
Yes.
All you gotta do is come in.
That's it.
All you gotta do is put it back in our hands. So
yes.
All you gotta do is give it back to us. Now. Interesting enough, one vehicle that was on the recall, the owner was shipping it, and they put it's a 2015 case. The car was put on a cargo ship. This entire ship caught on fire because of this vehicle. It cost $45 million in damages to the other vehicles on board, and $55 million in damage to the cargo, other cargo. One ignored recall letter. Can I tell you, we got a letter?
Yes.
We got a Bible that lets us know, that tells us, listen, we're all going to have flaws, right?
That's right, amen.
Just come back to the master. Just come back to the master. An unrepaired vessel is dangerous to a to those around it. I believe Peter showed us a glimpse of ourselves. And you also learned this lesson when in the upper room when Jesus rose from supper and girded himself, took a towel and girded himself and poured water into a basin and began to wash the feet. Peter's like, well, hold on, Jesus. Thou shalt never wash. Jesus answered him, if I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. There's no place for pride when it comes to the master's hands.
That's right, amen. Amen.
Well, Peter gives us not only wash all of me, not only my hands and feet, wash finished, that I've achieved something, eliminates me from being in the hands of the one that can help me get there. I wonder if anyone here wants to rethink your need of Jesus today. The vessel made was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to make it. Can I tell you, in all transparency and honesty, every time I walk in here, I'm asking Jesus to remake me.
Yes.
Every time I come to the house of God, our week of prayer and fasting that's continuing going on this week, life, oh God, remake me.
Yes.
Reshape me. Renew me. Restore me.
Yes.
Put your hands on me.
Yes.
Help me.
Yes.
I want to be a better husband. I want to be a better
dad.
I want to be a better pastor. I want to be a better Christian. There are so many places I need to improve. Remake me every day. Make me new. Like Peter, I never want to get to the place that I come in with the hands or the voice of the Father where I want to sit back and say, I don't need him. Maybe just one person today, you've kind of pushed back against the potter's hands, and maybe you felt unworthy, or maybe you were bitter, or maybe whatever it is that's there, I want to let you know Jesus is calling you and saying, I can fix you.
Yes.
I put a recall out. I've sent you a letter. I've been wooing you and trying to get you to come to me for a long time. And I wonder if there's someone here today.
Yeah.
You have to understand a vessel, a car with internal damage can catch fire and burn. $100 million worth of you and I can hurt each other if we don't stay in the Master's hand. I wonder if someone today would want to place themselves back in the Master's hand today.
Yes.
Jesus, don't wash just my hands and my feet. Wash all of me. Fix me. Fix my heart. Fix my mind. Fix my spirit. I want to open this all today for someone that wants to heed the letter, the recall. Fix me, Jesus.
Yes.
Fix me today. I've had ill will. I've been upset. I got sideways. I got some hardness in my heart. I got some hardness in my spirit. I want to be that soft mouth of fire and clay. Jesus. God, I want to be what you want to make.
That's what your mercy did for me.
okay? You came naked, you're going to go naked.
Hello?
You arrived weak, you're going to leave weak.
Hello?
You came without money and things, you're going to leave without money and things.
Hello?
Your first bath, someone washed you. Your last bath, someone will wash you.
Yes. Come on, Pastor.
Yes.
Come on.
All that matters. Oh God, what will I let you do with me? There's heroes in here.
Amen.
There's people in here that are going to do great things because you place yourself in the hand of God.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. This, you're just beginning to walk with Jesus.
That's
you're
right.
Getting started with Jesus. Let me tell you something. Vessels are hard on vessels.
Come on. Hello. Hello.
At our house.
Yes.
As the two ladies cringe. Our glasses and cups don't last long.
Oh.
That's good.
They bang up next to each other. They hurt each other.
Yes.
It's what we do.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
We bump up with one another. Boy, how much do you weigh? 200?
Not
200, so that's why 250 meets 225.
Oh, exactly. Yeah.
So, but if I get down here, I'm not going to hurt me.
No.
In the natural.
Yeah.
But in this, we do, we hurt one another.
Come on.
Yes.
Come on. Come on, Pastor.
Well, we can avoid that if we stop and realize, you know what? God's not finished with us.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
God's not finished with me.
Amen.
God's not done. There's some heroes in here. Some people are ready to give up, but you're going to recognize, you'll put your arm around. I'm not here to hurt you.
That's it.
That's right.
Let's go.
Stay in the master's hand. Some of you need to tell your children, stay in the master's hand. Some of you need to tell your children, stay in the master's hand. Some of you need to tell your children, stay in the master's hand. He's not finished with you.
Amen.
One day you're going to be the one reaching. One day you're going to be the one singing. One day you're going to be the one preaching. But never outgrow being used and in the will of God. So you can constantly be involved.
Amen.
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 He loves you.
Amen.
Cares about you.
Hallelujah.
I don't know if I said this the other day or not, but nothing bothers me more than the fact that people give themselves to this world and the world will give a rip about you. The world doesn't even care about its darlings.
Hello?
It definitely ain't going to care about us, but God cares.
Yes, He does. Amen.
And He always will love.
Amen.
It's like a prodigal. Yeah, you can leave. But thank God it's God that lets you come back. The world won't even let you come back and mess up.
Come on, preacher. Come on, tell them.
Watch how they treat their hurt.
Tell them.
Yeah. Are you hearing me?
Come on.
Tonight we're going to have a good time. You don't want to miss tonight. Ladies are going to be on point.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
You'll know this, but if you're a ladies' conference, you're going to be here in a few moments tonight. Okay? We just like to do that whenever we go to either youth camps or stuff like this.
Yeah.
So get with Sister Kofi at the ladies' conference. I don't know what it's called, the ladies' thing.
Yeah,
we're going to have a good time tonight. And then I've got something that I left out of this message that I'm going to share tonight to cap off. But we're going to have a good time with the Lord. Tonight's family night. No internet. No. We love y'all. But we like it when you're home.
Yes. Yes.
So we'll have a good time tonight.
Yes.
Come as a family, love as a family, fight as a family, stay together.
That's right, amen. Amen.
Thank you for being faithful to the house of God. Thankful for tolerating me. I know today wasn't normal, Pastor, but Lord, pray for me.
Yes.
Yes.
Pray for me.
Yes. Amen.
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 Paul, would you do me a favor today? Would you dismiss us in prayer?